Not everyone has Gigacha survival instincts like me, so unlike me, a lot of people won't be able to survive a Relcraft's early game without outside help. And that's exactly what this video will be, a helping hand. So you break some gravel, crack some flint, punch some leaves at max range. Remember that, breaking them can spawn hostile mobs. Make a flint knife and get some plant fiber.
Well, that's your first mistake.
Some won't do it. You need a fuck ton. And the reason for that is the ability to make wool out of plant string, which is made out of the fiber you just filled your inventory with. And you probably already know why that's good for us. So now you don't have to be afraid of the night. Unless a reaper spawns when you try to lie down in your newly created bed. In which case, the only thing I can say is GG skill issue get good. Nah, I'm just kidding. I'm here to help after all. When you want to go to sleep, make sure you have a roof over your head. Reapers can phase through walls, but their projectiles can't, meaning they won't inflict you with insomnia. But I believe you're not that much of a pussy, and your warrior heritage will make you want to take that motherfucker on. So before going to sleep, and after making the bed, you're gonna want to make yourself a throwing knife. But even before that, in case you're completely new to the game, you need a flint hatchet to chop down your first tree. Again, at max range. And then you right click the logs with it to get planks. With the knife in your hand, there's no need to fear the sleep interrupters. With two pieces of wood, you can craft some drippy AirPods, which will make you immune to being turned into a simp. If you need to drink, and you will, the best way to go around it is either making a canteen, filling it with water, and combining it with a charcoal filter, or just cooking water bottles. That way you avoid the parasites effect, which can, meaning that it most definitely will, attack your head. But if there are no sources of leather or sand nearby, I mean, the sand part is a bit of a stretch, but let's assume it's nowhere to be found for the sake of the argument. Then you have a few other options, such as drinking rain or drinking normal water if, and only if, there is a nymph nearby. She will outheal the parasite damage. One of the first things you should do is find a decent place to live in. Be it a random pre-generated structure with loot or a village, just find some. Actually, getting a lucky spawn is probably the most important thing as far as not dying goes. Meanwhile, the only spawns I ever get are oceans. Once you have a general grasp of where you want to stay, you should get some XP by mining coal. But you have to be careful, because mining also spawns unwanted guests. While battling them, don't switch to your sword or anything. Pickaxes deal bonus damage to them, so use this instead. Once you get some levels, you should get level 2 in farming and 4 in mining. The former lets you plant and harvest wheat, which is a great early game XP source, but again, breaking it can spawn various rape dwarves. And the latter lets you mine iron. Do I have to say it again? You should always have a sleeping bag in your inventory when leaving your home for a prolonged time. They let you skip the night without changing the spawn point. Make a shield. You will need it. Stockpile on bandages as soon as you can. This shouldn't be a problem because you listened to my advice from the beginning of the video.
Right?
These guys are hostile only when you're loud, so just don't run or attack them and you will be fine. And this will only get violent if there's an alpha chat nearby, otherwise they are too scared to attack. This mechanic leads to an interesting interaction where my presence triggers them, but it won't be a problem for you, so don't worry. Also, when you reach level 5 for the first time, press L and choose combat. Once you're a little geared up, you will want to choose a battle tower. As far as the lower floor chests go, you can access them through the wall. Unfortunately, some of them will be locked, and lockpicks are usually not worth the hassle, so just skip those. And don't go for the chests on the last two floors unless you have a hopper, because trying to open them normally will trigger the golem. Recall potions are decently abundant in the world of Relcraft, so you should always have a few in your inventory. You'll want to make some easy bubbles like the tool belt and reforge them until you get something nice. As for your weapon choice, they've all been nerfed to oblivion since the glorious days of 2.8, but I'd still stick to the rapier or a saber just because of the 25% damage received reduction. Survivability is everything at this stage of the game. If you're a pussy, real chats use the halberd. Speaking of survivability, if you get lucky and find this biome, you can kill a shambler, collect some mushrooms, right click on an iron ore with them, and mine it. Then you will need scarlet, and the best way to get it would be placing a diamond block anywhere in this biome on the ground. Then you just make this bad boy and wave death goodbye, because the innate lifesteal from this weapon makes you immortal. Almost. Also, there is this mob called Arizaur, and eating their smelted meat, preferably in the form of a paleo salad, will give you a boost to all the healing you receive. Connect the dots. At level 4 in agility, you unlock dodge rolling, which is very convenient when it comes to mobility and dodging attacks. Also, be aware that if you're too cold, you will die. And if you're too hot, like me for example, you will also die. Aussie liners take care of both of these problems, so if you ever come across them in a chest or something, be sure to grab them. There are also just cooling and just hitting liners, by the way, but they are worse for obvious reasons. All of the liners can be crafted, but honestly, if I were you, I would just... Yeah. Lastly, in the early game section, I'd like to mention Makamit. Makas don't fight back. You can peacefully genocide them, and after cooking their meat, they give you a few absorption hearts, which may prove very useful in any unwelcome mob encounters.
You know you're working hard when it feels like there isn't enough time in the day. Movie.
Take a look at the food wiki section. I could spend 10 minutes going over every single one of these, but there's no point. Just go check it out. Battle Burrito is the holy grail here, and if you happen to find this, which you probably won't, let's be real, you will not have to worry about endgame food ever again. So yeah, food is broken in this modpack, basically. The core concept you must understand before proceeding is that Shivaxi hates you. Yes, you specifically. Which is why he made getting a flying mount a tremendous hassle. You will need to kill a lot of crabs, silexes and ikas for the treats which you use to tame some of the flying mobs. And you'll have to spend ages looking for trolls because you need their tusks for the saddle. Remember to use a soul stone on the mob you tame so that it can be resummoned after it inevitably dies. But it's all giga worth it because a flying mount is the biggest quality of life improvement you can make in this game. An alternative route to all of this is getting lucky with finding or looting rabbit feet and taming a hippogriff, which can be piloted using just a normal saddle, but those can be soulstone. Some mobs you find in dungeons will drop chorus fruits. And if you make a switch bow and chorus arrows, you can just yeet the tower golem to Narnia and chillax as you rob him of his belongings. Mobs and spawners sometimes drop hard crystal shards, which you can turn into hard containers, which make you fit. There's this thing called a summoning staff, which you can use to command your own army that will help you clear dungeons and shit. But then again, a huge hassle, huge time sink, and it's like finishing Elden Ring using summons. You can, but I won't completely ignore it for the sake of the guide. So just to give you an idea of how it works, you create a soul gazer and gaze into the abyss of a mob carefully as not to allow it to gaze back. And after you do it a lot, you can call upon their soul to aid you in battle. Sounds pretty cucked, and that's because it is. This should go without saying, but continue upgrading your skill tree. Keep up your bubbles game as well, and once you have a decent weapon and armor, reforge them to respectively legendary and masterful. Keep in mind that there are two different reforging stations. There are bounty boards in villages that give you a reward for completing some random quests. But you should probably ignore them because they are utter garbage. You should start delving into enchanting more seriously at this stage, prioritizing lifesteal, vampirism, sharpness, and venomed and viper on your weapon and protection on your helmet and chestplate. Get a poison stone ASAP to synergize with your enchantments to drown your foes in enormous damage numbers. After your gear is decent, you can start looking for a dragon to take down. Then you dismember its corpse and use the remains of that sky lizard to make even better gear. The mobs that burn purple are stupidly strong and give insane amounts of XP, so if you can kill them, you should. And there is a great video on YouTube showcasing a system that lets you consistently farm those. I will link to it in the description.
I'm an intellectually gifted person.
Let's start this section with alcoholism. Brewing wine is OP in Erelcraft. Grape wine extends the duration of the potion effects you have on you at the time of drinking it, and wildberry wine increases their level up to 3. This will give you all sorts of debuffs, and you will need something like coffee, ale, forbidden fruit, or ideally an Ankshild to get rid of them. And wine is made by crushing berries with your feet in a crushing tub. And then you use a brewing station to brew it. There's a quality system in place. The bigger the number, the better. So if you get lucky with a good bottle, you can just put it in the left slot. This makes all the new wine you brew match its quality. These are the best enchantments for your melee weapon, this for your bow, and this for your armor. Feel free to pause the video as needed. And you'll want the broken heart for the death prevention effect, which, as of 2.9.2, seems to actually be working correctly. Now it should be a good time to actually beat the game. Make this altar, activate with a soul key, kill the mob, craft the demonic soul cube, make this altar in the nether, activate it, kill Rachova. Make this, activate it, kill the mob, make the cube, build this in the end, activate, kill. Build, activate, kill, craft. Make a silver armor and enchant it heavily. Then you can proceed. When you're geared to utter oblivion, you can enter the Lost Cities dimension by placing a bet on Sin Sina Cite, lanterns, and surrounding it with skulls. And the material you make them with can be found in Poland. Once there, you can kill mobs and loot buildings in order to obtain some endgame rings as well as the best endgame weapons, each with its own unique perk. The cleaver seems to be the best. And remember that flight potions are your friend when it comes to navigating and surviving this place. This is also the dimension in which you can fight the final boss, and during this fight you have to be careful not to get sucked. Because if you get sucked, you die. But if you win, you get rewarded the best bubble in the game. That will be all. Subscribe and like the video, please.